is Wednesday, August 21st, 2024. Happy birthday to RJ Mite. He played Walt Jr. in Breaking Bad. He's 32 today. One of the fastest men in the history of mankind has a birthday today. Usain Bolt turns 38. And Kellis still bringing the boys to the yard at 45. And then Kim Cattrall from Sex and the City.
Hello.
It's over. I told my wife.
Who is this?
She's 68 today. Do the rock away. Fat Joe and his Terror Squad had the number one song with Lean Back 20 years ago. And back in 2017, nothing I can say, a total eclipse of the sun occurred that was visible to most of North America. Fun 107. Morning and happy hump day. You're going to expect kind of a fall-ish day today, if I don't say so myself. At least this morning. We will see highs in the 70s later today, but it is 58 now.
Bring in your taste of Hollywood right here to the South Coast. And we are here for it. We're spilling the tea with Maddie's entertainment update on the Michael and Maddie Show.
Jennifer Lopez has done what seemed inevitable. She's filed for divorce from Ben Affleck. But there are some major twists, including the symbolism of when she finally decided to do it. She filed the legal documents yesterday in Los Angeles, but they were not filed by a lawyer. They were filed pro per, meaning by herself and without an attorney.
Wow.
She lists the date of separation as April 26th, 2024. The couple got married in Las Vegas on July 16th, 2022. However, August 20th, is also significant for Bennifer because that marks the second anniversary of the huge and more traditional wedding ceremony they held in Georgia. So it hardly seems like a coincidence that she filed that day. So the real shocker is that J-Lo does not say in her documents whether there's a prenup. And sources are saying there is indeed no prenuptial agreement. That would mean whatever earnings or profit Ben and Jen made during their 2 years of marriage is community property.
What?
So, for instance, since they tied the knot, Ben's starred in Air. He's been in Hypnotic. He produced The Instigators. He also wrapped up The Accountant 2 a couple days ago. And as for J-Lo, she had the movie Shotgun Wedding, The Mother, This Is Me Now, Atlas. And what's shocking, this is J-Lo's fourth marriage, Ben's second. You would think she'd have that prenup on lockdown. But apparently they thought this was a forever thing and it didn't quite work out that way. Jennifer waived spousal support and is asking the judge to deny Ben such support as well. They did not have children together. No custody issues there. But for the final big twist, you would think everything has been hashed out money-wise, but that's not the case. I guess they put their marital home in Beverly Hills up for sale. Ben bought his own house in Brentwood, and she's currently looking for a new house. So they've been trying to hash out a settlement for months. Sources saying those talks are continuing, but they have become increasingly acrimonious to the point at times they're not even speaking to each other. So why did J-Lo decide to file while they're still battling over money? Well, even though it doesn't really matter legally who files first, sometimes PR concerns are involved when it comes to who files first. So, sounds like they just fell out of love, which is super, super sad.
I thought he bought Shakira's mansion. Or was that maybe rumor?
Well, they bought a house, and now they're selling it. I don't know if it was Shakira's or not.
I'm wondering if, because I heard Nancy talking about this the other day in the afternoon, and she was saying how strange it was. They're together. The name was only on Ben, you know, for the house. And it's like, did he just buy the super mansion just to have a toy collection? But now it makes sense. I mean, yeah, it's sad. I liked them together.
I know. I did like them too, but they're just so different. They're so different.
They are.
So hopefully this is the last time they try this whole thing again. Adam Sandler recently on The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon to talk about the highly anticipated sequel, Happy Gilmore 2. Everybody's getting so pumped up about this. I'm getting pumped up. And he kind of let us know on what to expect for the sequel.
It's good.
It's good. Like, we worked hard on the script, man. We didn't want to let anybody down. People have been asking me for a long time, do Happy Gilmore 2? And I was always like, nah, I'll only let you down. But then me and my buddy Tim Herlihy, we came up with this idea. We're really excited about it. We're continuing to try to make it a movie that you guys will like. And I think we're excited. So many of the golfers are being nice and they're going to be a part of it and all.
I have a feeling there is going to be so many cameos.
Oh, yeah.
They were talking about Travis Kelce wants to be a part of it. Professional golfers, people from the original movie. Rob Schneider was recently interviewed. He said he's probably in it. This is going to be a great, great movie. It's funny, though, how he said, like, I didn't want to make it for so long because I didn't want to disappoint people. That's such a real thing.
It is. It is. And he's so down to earth when it comes to that. And he's real when it comes to that.
Yeah.
I hope there's some kind of tribute to Chubbs.
Yeah.
I hope there's
something. I'm sure there will be.
He comes down from heaven or something like that.
Something or like a flashback or something. Something. But what about that swing, Adam? He said he still has to practice that a bit.
I did it. I have to practice. You know, you got a hop, skip, and a hit. And I did it recently. But, you know, it seems simple, so I tried it out. I fell. I laid there for a while, and then somebody brought me a lemonade, and I just kind of laid down on the ground drinking a lemonade for a while. But I'll be ready when it comes when it's time to shoot. I'm a gamer.
I mean, that swing, you could throw your back out real fast. Real fast.
We used to, senior year of high school, get out early, head down to Caddyshack in Dartmouth, and try that swing, and they do not like it down
there.
I don't recommend doing that at any golf
course.
Please
don't go to Top Golf and try to do the Happy Gilmore, okay? You're just going to get kicked out.
Label!
This is huge. This is very niche, but those that get it, okay? Playground Productions will revive the popular 90s and early 2000s video game series, Backyard Sports, baby. I'm so excited. So Backyard Sports was the computer game series that allowed players to rule the field, court, rink, whatever it was, and it is making a comeback. Playground Productions, a company aiming to produce family-friendly content, plans to revive the franchise over the next few months across multiple mediums, including new video games, merchandise, film, television.
Wow.
This was launched in 1997, okay? I was 4 years old at the time. I was playing in the early 2000s when we had a computer room at my daycare of the person who was watching me. It was me and a bunch of kiddos, and that's when, you know, digital started.
It really did.
We gathered around the community computer and we would take turns playing backyard baseball, and it was the best game ever.
It's good nostalgia. Tell me
that
much.
It is such good nostalgia. I would always want to be Ichiro, I believe.
Oh.
He was like the best one. Yeah. Oh my God. I love this game.
The big heads too.
The huge heads, yeah. But the question is, did the Kelce brothers manifest this return? So I guess they were talking about it on their very popular podcast recently.
Remember backyard football on the computer growing up?
Oh, dude, I don't even know if I want to mention this. I've secretly been looking into seeing if anybody holds the rights to backyard football and backyard baseball, because I want to buy it and get this thing going again. That was the best game ever.
Dude,
it was so
fun.
It was so electric. Can you imagine playing backyard football right now on your phone? Because you could do that whole thing on your phone.
Play ball.
I love it. It's so funny. So there's no word whether they are involved with this comeback. However, all of the New Heights social media accounts posted about the game's return on August 20th, joking that it's getting added to the list of things we've manifested.
Yes.
So I don't know if they're involved, but it's just a weird coincidence for sure.
If you think about it real quick, couldn't that, and I know you mentioned TV, isn't that like an incredible show for kids? Because it's kind of
It could
that
definitely be a kid's show
vibe.
For sure. For sure. The only problem is it's based off of real baseball players and like real players.
So give them a check.
Yeah.
Give them a check.
Maybe. Yeah. You're on to something here. More entertainment up now on the Fun 107. Good morning. It is sunny, but it feels like school. You know what I'm saying?
It does.
Like, it's got that air this morning where it's like, school.
I can smell the fresh
it is
kicks.
Here. It is here. So yeah, it's a little chilly this morning, but we will see highs in the 70s later today, and it is around 67 now. Happy Wet Nose Wednesday. Now, we typically have adorable pups. Today, we have an adorable kitten. We actually have two kittens that have bonded together, because here's the deal. The star of the show is Forrest, and he's adorable. He's 3.5 months old, and he's under the care of Moby Kit Rescue, which is a foster-based rescue. They don't have a physical shelter, but he's being fostered in Fall River. And he's got a sister, Jenny. Forrest was born with a deformed back leg, and it can cause some issues, but thankfully he's not in pain. But you know, a deformed back leg will slow you down just a bit. Not Forrest, though. He still gets the zoomies. He still has a ton of playing time with his sister, Jenny. And he loves to chase her around. Loves a good cat nap. And he just loves to take up space in your arms or on your lap. But he will have to get that deformed leg amputated. So Moby Kit Rescue is going to pay for the surgery. They're going to help, you know, Forrest amputate that leg and rehab and stuff. But he needs a family that's going to love him unconditionally for who he is as a kitten and just take care of him and make sure that he feels loved and adopt Jenny with him.
You're crushing me right now. You know this is my vice. Forrest Gump is my favorite movie. Oh, now I'm going to go home with two kittens. My wife's going to look at me.
Listen, they need a home. They're only 3.5 months old. Oh, they're nice and like these tiny little things. And Jenny is basically the support, the emotional support for Forrest. They're inseparable. They need to be adopted together. The ideal adopter is someone who's home a lot. So perhaps a remote worker or has a quiet home environment. Children are okay as long as they're a little older. And the house needs to be a little cat savvy. If you own cats, you know what that means. But they would be comfortable with cats and dogs in a similar setting with a proper introduction. But if you see the picture up on the Fun 107 app, Forrest is a sweetie pie. Oh, look at man. That face. Are
I
you
wish
kidding?
It didn't.
Look at that face. And then look at him with his sister. Are you kidding? Are you kidding?
All right, Jenny, if you're listening, you hear me and you hear me now. You do not leave Forrest. You don't go out on tour. You don't leave and go halfway across the world. No, you stay with Forrest because he's only got three. He's going to have three legs.
I know. Oh, but he's such a sweetie pie. And the shelter saying he's got such a personality on him. And let's just find these two a home together, okay? Can we do that? So head over to the Fun 107 app, fun107.com. Check out Forrest. Reach out to Moby Kit Rescue. Let's find him a forever home, okay? Wet Nose Wednesday, proudly brought to you by First Citizens Federal Credit Union and Wolf and Bear. It's on Fun 107. Good morning. It is Michael and Maddie.
So don't get mad at me. I owe some apologies to some people out there. I know you're not going to be on board with this.
Oh, boy.
I've been a bit of a hypocrite lately.
And, boy.
I think it all came down the line yesterday. And especially this morning when we woke up, can you feel it in the air? It's fallish.
What are you doing?
What are you doing? I'm speeding up the year by a week. Okay. Now you and I agreed September 1st is like a nice kind of even blank.
No, after Labor Day.
Oh, that's right. I said September 1st. Well, when's Labor Day?
So Labor Day, I can tell you right now, is on September 2nd.
Oh, God, fine. All right, so September 2nd. So that's about a week away. I might hang it up.
Hang up what?
Summer? Maybe.
You.
I'm sorry.
We can't be friends.
Well, here's the thing. I went for a nice stroll yesterday, a nice little walk, and it was just very fall-esque in the air. This morning, crisp. I hate to say it. I was this close to putting my heat on in the car. I didn't do it. I didn't.
I did
this close. But you know what really got me in the mood yesterday is the fact that I missed out on it yet last year, but Buzz's Bay Brewing has this cornfield, corn maze. I've never done a corn maze before.
Really?
I've never done it.
They're fun.
I would get lost. You know me.
Yeah. It definitely happens.
But now there's beer involved. So I'm thinking, plaid, pumpkin beer, maybe, or even just a beer in general, and corn mazes. It got me in my feels, and I'm over there sitting on my couch like, what is happening?
I'm going to expose all of the South Coast and New England right now, okay?
Ready.
This is the period where we are ridiculous human beings.
Yes.
Because from now, when people start getting excited about fall, till about, I don't know, October 1st, it's still warm.
It's going to be hot.
It is still very warm. And you're going to be out there in your plaid and Uggs, sipping on pumpkin beer and hot chai and pulling out your clothes for fall season, sweating. You're going to be sweating.
Oh, yeah.
And we all do it. I'm guilty of it, too. I have all of my plaids waiting, ready to go. You know, I went boot shopping the other day. Like, it's happening.
But this is weird weather, right? Am I not wrong on that? I don't recall it being
colder than normal.
For August.
I would say so, for sure.
My wedding anniversary is in 2 months to this day, and it was hot.
Yeah.
That was a hot day. If it wasn't for the rain, I guarantee you it would have been a sweltering day. So, again, there's my apology, maybe to you as well, but like... I don't know. It's grasping. There's a force behind this seasonal fall grab that is just
gravitational pull.
I don't know. But again, I digress. If you want to check out this corn maze, that's what this is all about. I just want to go into corn maze. It's not until September, by the way. So,
okay. So I can get on board.
Now you can get on board. So September 6th. All right. Right after Labor Day. So you don't got to worry about feeling the pressure of, you know, the division of, is it still summer? Is it fall? You know, these people, by the way, that say, oh, I'm ready for fall. The second it turns fall, they'll be ready for snow. The second it snows, they'll be ready for the heat.
You guys are never satisfied,
never
are
satisfied.
You? 107, Michael and Maddie.
So I've been holding on to this grudge for a while now. And yesterday was kind of the boiling point where I don't know if you jinxed me after we left the studio yesterday, but do you remember the last thing you said to me?
Ooh.
We're about to leave. I was hopping on my bike.
Oh, I said be safe.
Be safe.
Yeah.
Have a safe ride home. And it was horrifying.
Oh, jeez.
Horrifying.
No.
Yesterday, you know what? I should have just left the bike at home. Now, I've been trying to get outdoors as much as I can before, I'll be honest, the cold weather comes.
Right.
Obviously, you can ride your bike up until November. So yesterday, I'm late for work by like a minute or two, and I end up scrambling to get to my bike to get here. I like taking the bike in the morning for like a nice mosey, a nice relaxing. It wakes me up.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just like Tour de France all the way here. As fast as I could, I'm praying I didn't hit the bridge. Thankfully, I didn't. And I made it here. It was fine. Okay. It was stressful. So I'm like, all right, we had a great show yesterday. I go to leave. I'm going to take my time. Headphones in. Sun is shining. It was beautiful. I get maybe, I don't know, Maddie, 1,000 feet down Route 6 in Fairhaven. Some guy almost hits me.
Jeez.
Pulling out of a side lot there, but like barreling out, okay? Obviously, they're going to stop. But what happens is these cars, they pull out. So they're like, their nose is past the sidewalk.
Yeah.
With no regard to if anybody's on the sidewalk. I've never been so, my heart was like, just stopped for a second. I may have said some profanities, and usually I lost my cool. And to the point where I stopped in front of this guy, and I'm putting, I do the arm thing.
Oh, you did the arm thing.
I did the arm thing.
And hands in the air thing. But
I can't. That was my boiling point. And I'm like, wow. And it wasn't even a sorry. He's just like, what do you want me to do? What do I want you to do?
Be a little bit more courteous. Man.
It's just, I hate to even kind of nag on this. It's been a long time coming. And the sad part, it's right here in Fairhaven. I'll put you on blast.
So do you
not
think
all Fairhaven, but commuters in Fairhaven.
Do you think it's just because Route 6 maybe doesn't typically have bike riders and walkers?
Well, there's a bike lane.
So there you go.
There are signs in the road that say, you know, like the little person on the bikes painted on the road.
Just people not paying attention.
People not paying attention. There are more signs in Fairhaven that say share the road than anywhere else that I know in the South Coast. Honest to God.
That's so weird.
And then I go into New Bedford, hustle and bustle in city of New Bedford. No issues. Never.
That's funny.
Maybe because it's a little bit more, like a lot more people are on their bikes, you know,
yeah,
in New Bedford.
Maybe they're like more, yeah, more cautious.
More stop signs, more. I've never had an issue in New Bedford. It's this one strip on Route 6 that just like really.
It's reminding me of what happened to Gordon Ramsay in Connecticut.
Yes, like come on, I'm just trying to get home.
T-boned by a car.
I can't. It was that bad. I thought I was going to get T-boned.
Ugh, that's scary.
The guy's coming out. I had to slam on my brakes, and it's all downhill. So yeah, I'm clipping a little bit, but I'm also watching where I'm going. This is just a PSA. I'm not trying to really like dig into Fairhaven, but you know, Route 6 is becoming a bit of like a speedway here. Yeah. You know, and
or just people not paying attention.
Oh gosh, I can't. Like I can still feel the
that's all right. Take a breath. So. You're safe. You're safe. Safe with me.
I feel better now. Thank you. I feel
better. It is 7:49. Let's take a look at the headlines. Here's Phil Devitt.
The victim and suspect in Tuesday's homicide in New Bedford South End have been identified. Police responded to a report of a man with an injury at the Ciabra Foods on Rockdale Avenue around 3:40 a.m. Upon arrival, first responders found the man, later identified as 58-year-old Stephen Oswald of New Bedford, suffering from a fatal head injury. 31-year-old Nina Busningo of Mattapoisett has been arrested in connection. She's expected to be arraigned in court today. The investigation is ongoing. A Tiverton man has been sentenced to 8 years in prison with 4.5 years suspended for a deadly hit-and-run crash. 27-year-old Paul Gomes pleaded no contest to a charge of duty to stop in an accident resulting in death. Gomes was driving on West Main Road in May of 2020 when he struck the bicyclist and fled the scene. 40-year-old Elias Velasquez Chavez of Newport died from his injuries. In addition to prison time, Gomes must pay a fine of $5,000, and he will lose his driver's license for 3 years. Former President Obama says Kamala Harris and Tim Walz are the leaders America needs right now.
If we work like we've never worked before, if we hold firm to our convictions, we will elect Kamala Harris as the next president of the United States.
Speaking at the Democratic National Convention Tuesday night, he went after Donald Trump, saying re-electing him would be dangerous. Obama said Harris will get up every morning and fight for the American people. Massachusetts Secretary of State Bill Galvin is back in the state after leaving the DNC. He's acting governor while the governor and lieutenant governor are in Chicago. And as students head back to school across the country, the U.S. Department of Agriculture is asking parents to be aware of potential food allergens. USDA program specialist Zoya Sattar has tips on how to pack children's safe lunches.
To teach your child to, you know, wash your hands before and after eating, identify what those allergens look like. And this may be a little hard, but don't share food with friends if in case they do get sick or your own child gets sick.
According to the USDA, 1 in 13 children has a food allergy. To make sure kids are safe as they head to the cafeteria, experts say parents should be aware of 9 food allergens, including milk, fish, eggs, shellfish, tree nuts, peanuts, wheat, soybeans, and sesame, which was just added this year. In sports, Red Sox evened their series with the Astros at a game apiece after holding on for a 6-5 victory in Houston last night. They'll look to capture the rubber match this afternoon. Game starts at 2:10. The WNBA has played a regular season game in Boston for the first time in league history. Connecticut Sun were the home team last night at TD Garden in a game with the Los Angeles Sparks, and they won 69-61. Patriots' final preseason game coming up Sunday with the Washington Commanders. Traffic and weather next. From the Blue Point Restaurant Newsroom, I'm Phil Devitt for Fun 107.
Fun 107, Michael and Maddie. I love going to downtown Providence whenever I can because the food scene is unreal. G Pub is one of my spots I like to go to. Have you been there?
G Pub's good.
G Pub's fun. The rooftop is super fun, but sometimes my wallet can't handle the rooftop. So we go to G Pub, and it's just like, I feel like it's one of those places, if you don't know about it, you may walk right by it. It's right in downtown Providence. You have to go downstairs, and it's like, basically in the basement of this giant skyscraper type building. But their menu is super good, very fun, you know, kind of like an upscale pub situation. And they have a colossal food challenge right now. It is insane. I had to do a double take to see if it was even real, but this is real. It is not one sandwich. It is multiple sandwiches put together. They're calling it the Fame or Shame. I'm going to go with shame because if you finish this, I don't even know. Ready for this? 2 Leaning Towers, compiled of 4 double cheeseburgers stacked between grilled cheeses, topped with a house cheese sauce, applewood bacon, fried onion rings, lettuce, tomato sauce, and 4 buffalo chicken sliders. And then a pound of chili cheese fries.
And this is a timed event.
I just can't even.
This is where restaurants are going downhill with
you. You have to finish this in 30 minutes.
No, it's not doable. I can tell you why. I did a burger that was a minuscule that size here in Dartmouth, and I couldn't even come close to it. And I'm telling you right now, it's not even. If you can do this, A, you belong in a Hall of Fame internationally, and B, you might need to call your doctor.
Because definitely have your doctor on standby. Because it's not even worth
it. Like, first of all, it looks tasty. Like, I would like to just sit there and enjoy it, but like, give me some time. I don't want to be 30 minutes trying to rush through that.
My question is why? Why? So, not only will you get it for free if you finish in 30 minutes, but you'll also get enshrined on the G-Pub's Wall of Fame.
Great. No, thank you. And I'll tell you why.
Guess how much this is?
That's got to be...
Guess how much this is if you don't finish it for free?
Close to $100 easily. It's got to be.
$95.
Yeah, see, I mean, that's where they get you. A half an hour,
and
they're going to win every time.
It gets better. You get forever ridiculed on their Wall of Shame.
Yeah.
So you either go on the Wall of Fame or you end up on the Wall of Shame. That is hilarious.
I will say those sliders at the top, the buffalo chicken ones, look pretty darn good.
Look at all this bread, though. 1, 2, 3, 4. You got like 8 slices of bread because of the bun situation.
Yep. And then the fries.
Then the fries. Then the bacon.
It's carb overload.
I could never. I could never. Could you do 1 tower?
Oh, man. No. No. The answer is no.
I don't think I could either.
If you look in the middle of one of those towers, so that's about a good.
That's a double chi right there.
That's a fifth of everything there. That's the challenge I tried at one point in time. And I could not do it. And that came with a pound of fries. That came with a milkshake. Very thick stuff. This is great marketing strategy because people are talking about it. We're talking about it. It's just not doable.
This reminds me of when I was younger and I was with my family. And one of them tried the awful, awful challenge at Newport Creamery. And I think it was like if you finish 2, you get the 3rd one free.
So it's like a frap, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And it's a cabinet, but that's neither here nor there. If you finish the 2, you get the 3rd one free. He finishes the 2, vomits everywhere.
Oh, no, thank you.
Everywhere. I would absolutely vomit. Vomit. But listen, go check out the picture. Sign up if you think you can do it.
Yeah, don't let me crush your dreams.
Seriously.
Go for it if you think you can. My days are numbered.
Get your mind blown on the Fun 107 app. It is crazy. Let's head over to the WBSM newsroom now. Here's Phil Devitt.
A 31-year-old woman has been arrested in connection with a homicide that occurred early Tuesday morning in New Bedford. Nina Busnango, with the last known address in Mattapoisett, is facing charges of assault and battery by means of a dangerous weapon. The incident took place at the Ciabra Foods on Rockdale Avenue in the city's south end. Around 3:40 a.m. on Tuesday, first responders discovered 58-year-old man, later identified as Stephen Oswald, suffering from a fatal head injury. He was pronounced dead on scene. The specific weapon used in the attack has not been released. A Tiverton man has been sentenced to prison for a hit-and-run crash that killed a bicyclist in Middletown, Rhode Island. Paul Gomes pleaded no contest to a charge of duty to stop in an accident, resulting in death. He was sentenced to 3.5 years in prison, followed by probation. Gomes struck the bicyclist, 40-year-old Elias Joel Velasquez Chavez, while driving on West Main Road in May of 2020. He fled the scene, but was later arrested and ID'd through video evidence and witness tips. Gomes was also ordered to pay a fine and lose his license. Michelle Obama telling Democrats to do something to get Kamala Harris elected president, the former first lady rallying the crowd at Tuesday's Democratic National Convention in her hometown of Chicago and told them don't sit around and complain about things, do something.
If we start feeling that dread creeping back in, we got to pick ourselves up, throw water on our face, and what?
Do something.
We only have 2.5 months, y'all, to get this done.
She also said while her husband, Barack Obama, was president, GOP candidate Donald Trump felt threatened by the existence of, quote, 2 hardworking, highly educated, successful people who also happened to be black. DNC continues today. And it's becoming more common for people to blur images of their homes on Google Maps. People are doing this as a precaution against burglaries and home invasions. The process is simple. Users must enter their address into Google Maps and select Street View, go to the settings, and then select Report a Problem. From there, users can request that Google blur portions of their house. It's unclear how long it takes to approve the changes. In sports, Red Sox bounced back from an opening night loss, defeating the Astros 6-5 in Houston yesterday to even their series. They'll aim to clinch the series today in the rubber match with the first pitch scheduled for 2:10. Boston also hosting its first ever WNBA regular season game last night, with the Connecticut Sun taking on the Los Angeles Sparks at TD Garden. Sun emerged victorious, winning 69-61. And the Patriots back at it with their final preseason game on Sunday with the Washington Commanders. Traffic and weather next. From the Blue Point Restaurant Newsroom, I'm Phil Devitt for Fun 107.
Fun 107, Michael and Maddie. Now, what do we have here? I feel like Airbnbs and resorts and getaways, they're getting more and more extravagant. We just saw the Polly Pocket House in Littleton, Massachusetts, which is the cutest little thing. But I'm still confused as to how you sleep in it, because it's open and it's plastic. And I'm just confused by the whole thing.
I think it got the attention of, is it Tyra Banks?
Tyra Banks wants to film Life-Sized 3 there.
3? I didn't know it was a part 2.
I know. Man. I didn't realize it either until I had to do a little research on that one. But there is a Cape Cod resort that has a pretty, honestly, I'll be honest with you, when I first saw these pictures, I thought it was AI. I thought it wasn't real.
It looks AI-ish, yeah.
But this is very real. And it is the Rice Krispies Lover's Dream. So Rice Krispies Treats, okay? It is the Retreat Suite by Rice Krispies Treats. It's at the Red Jacket Beach Resort.
Oh, my God.
And it's a little getaway, less than an hour away from the South Coast. And it is themed appropriately with Rice Krispies blue decor. But this is like over the top.
Over the top.
We're talking wallpaper, couches,
bunk beds,
decor, like just everything is Rice Krispie blue and Rice Krispie treats. It's cool. Don't get me wrong. But I just don't get it.
Yeah, how much? I love Rice Krispie treats. Like, honestly, if you gave me a box of them, I could eat a whole box.
Really?
I could. Yeah.
I don't know. They just never did it for me. They really didn't.
I like how they're like just full of sugar. That's that's hard
I
to
guess
get.
So.
But did
I
you
guess.
See they got
my
like
a, teeth hurt just thinking about it.
They are. The little treat yourself.
Yeah, I'm digging this treat yourself bar with like candy
you
and
get
stuff
to make
like that.
Your own in a sense. Well, that's
I
what
like
it looks
that.
Like.
All right. I can get down with that. I can definitely get down with that. There's a craft table. There's a Rice Krispies treat camera. I mean, this is kind of cool. This is definitely a unique experience. Like, if you're with your family and you have young kids and you stay
family.
Here,
yes.
This is really cool. Treat dreams. Oh, that's clever. Oh, that's very clever.
But how bad?
Look
do
at
you
these
like-
bunk beds. They're Rice Krispies.
Oh my God.
This is fantastic.
You actually get to sleep on it. You got to be an avid. This, you know what this is? This is the Oscar Mayer Wienermobile equivalent. In a sense. So like everybody goes nuts over the Wienermobile and they always want to take a picture of it. But then what? You move on with your life.
Yeah.
So you go to this Rice Krispie treat resort getaway. Cool. Yeah. Looks really neat and interesting. But like I'm good after one night. You know, can you imagine staying
this
there for
a whole
week?
This is
a
one and done for me. Yeah.
It's a one and done. You know, I'm not hating on it. I think this is a clever idea because there are so many resorts, so many Airbnbs. You have to stand out among the rest to get noticed.
Yeah.
That's what they did. How much Rice Krispie treats can you eat?
I mean, don't tempt me with a good time, but you know, I don't know. There's
a sweet escape, I guess.
There's still time to book a room as well. So find the details on the Fun 107 app. If you were to win the lottery, would you remain anonymous? Fun 107, it's Michael and Maddie. And a New Bedford man recently won $4 million on a scratch ticket. And the story is actually very entertaining. I will answer the question with, I would probably stay anonymous because I'm not trying to hear from my second, third cousin, twice removed aunt, you know, type of thing where they're like, oh, you know, remember that time I gave you $20 in a birthday card or something, like, you know, just silly stuff like that. I would probably stay on the low key, but not this man. He's very excited. And his name is Robert. I'm going to not give his last name because you never know. But he was shopping for a friend to find a birthday present. So he's looking for a birthday present. He goes, you know what? I'm going to stop into Jay's Wine and Spirits in Dartmouth. On Dartmouth Street in New Bedford. And he gets himself a scratch ticket. $10 worth. $4 million later.
That's crazy, right?
Are you kidding me?
So word on the street, it couldn't have happened to a better person. Teacher over at Volk Tech, who has just been absolutely, you know, he's loved by his peers, his students. He's just a great guy all around.
I love that. He said that he plans on doing some home renovations and helping others with his winnings. But see? My question is, you were shopping for somebody's birthday.
Oh, man.
You were technically getting a gift for your friend. Do you give some of the winnings to the birthday person?
I wonder if that friend also got a lottery ticket or a scratch ticket or something, you know? Mm. And was this a lottery ticket, by the way, or a scratch
ticket? A scratch ticket.
Okay, so here's what went down in my mind. He bought one for his friend. He bought one for himself. Which one do you put in the card? Wow. So now, if you're the friend of that birthday, do you say, hey, man, I'm putting two and two together now. It's out there. You were getting me a birthday gift. That's what you got me. Yeah, I only won maybe $5, or maybe it was a non-winner. Yeah, that is that's a conundrum right there.
You know, because it's like you were clearly shopping for your friend, and then you ended up being the real winner here.
Oh, man, I don't know.
Do you share it? I mean, I don't know. I don't think I would share.
This is a very tight-knit community. To be able to keep that a secret is going to be tough.
Well, I've seen people, when they go to collect their winnings, they'll have a lawyer collect it for them.
Yes.
Or they'll wear a mask. Did you see the one where the guy wore a scream mask?
Yeah.
That was so funny. But there's ways where you can stay anonymous. I would 100% stay anonymous.
In this case, yes. Before I'd be like, all right, whatever. Like, come at me. What are you going to do? You're going to hack into my bank account? Which I actually probably
People have done that, dude.
Yeah.
Come on.
But knowing that this was a potentially, oh, man. All right, so one more thing here. If he swapped those, he got the non-winner, but his friend got the $4 million.
Oh,
okay.
That would hurt.
It's your birthday. I give you the winning one.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead. First thing that comes off your mouth, what are you doing?
I'm giving you some.
Yeah.
I'm giving you some.
And you can be modest. How much?
Oh, God. I would have to. Well, so here's the thing, right? It's like he scratched a $4 million scratcher.
Yeah.
But he goes home with like 2.7 or something along those lines.
Yeah.
So it's like I'd love to be like, oh, you know, I'll give him a million or something. But then I only get a million.
Yeah.
And then in this economy, come on. That $1 million is gone so fast.
It's a million you didn't have, though. It's a million you didn't have.
I'm not giving a cent to you.